Thank Don Cravens for being our moderator for the first panel today and being a part of the second panel. Don, along with being the better half of my chief of staff, he is also the executive director of the Washington Urban League. I know I'm in trouble already, but we might as well start early, okay? I've just met with this wonderful group of young Americans that you are going to hear from today. They're quite engaging, they're very smart, and they are on the front lines as far as how local law enforcement interacts with our community. You know, over the last year, I have spent a lot of time in Ferguson listening to young people. And if you truly listen to them with an open mind and a kind heart, they will tell you what's really going on inside of them. They will tell you what's really happening in their lives. And when you hear a young person shouting, "Black Lives Matter," what they are really saying is that they know the ugly truth, that in America in 2015, their lives are not worth as much and are not valued in the same way as other Americans who don't look like them. The undeniable truth, backed up by data, is that the juvenile justice system often treats them as if they are disposable and they're angry about it. And I'm angry too, because I have seen firsthand how the many deeply rooted injustices and disparities in our judicial system are planted early and then ripen into a bitter harvest. 2 days after Michael Brown was killed, I contacted then Attorney General Eric Holder to request two urgent investigations. Those investigations resulted in a DOJ report that confirmed 26 different constitutional violations in the Ferguson Police Department and the Ferguson Municipal Court. Based on what the DOJ discovered and also incorporating the key recommendations from President Obama's Task Force on 21st Century Policing and the Ferguson Commission, I introduced several pieces of legislation to transform the way that local law enforcement and the criminal justice system interacts with communities of color, including leveraging DOJ grants to encourage body cameras for all police officers, enhancing sensitivity training to help officers do a better job of interacting with minorities, and most importantly, requiring the appointment of an independent prosecutor to review all cases where police use deadly force. There are many lessons from Ferguson, but the roots of the injustice that fueled the explosions we saw in Ferguson, Baltimore, and many other places didn't start with Michael Brown or Freddie Gray. They started much earlier in a juvenile justice system that perpetuates inequality at many levels. Almost a year before Mike Brown was killed, the Department of Justice initiated another major investigation in my district. And this time the target was the St. Louis County Family Court. The findings, which were released about 6 weeks ago, are as shocking as anything that DOJ uncovered in Ferguson. The report states, and I quote, the St. Louis County Family Court routinely deprives juveniles of constitutional rights, treats black youth more harshly than whites, and is rife with conflicts of interest. The DOJ Civil Rights Division determined that juveniles do not get adequate legal representation. They are held without proper determination of probable cause, and they are steered away from an informal handling of their cases unless they confess wrongdoing, which may coerce them into admitting something they did not do. This report also states that adjusted for factors other than race, black youths are 2.5 times more likely than whites to be incarcerated before trial and 3 times more likely to be sent to the Division of Youth Services on parole violations. The DOJ also found that in many instances, the juvenile court structure leaves the accused without any independent advocate who does not also work for the court. As Deputy Assistant Attorney General Vanita Gupta noted in the St. Louis Post-Dispatch, and I quote, I think there are concerns about the operation of juvenile justice systems around the country, but certainly along the racial disparities line, St. Louis County stood out. In the quote, the report also noted that there is just one juvenile public defender handling almost 400 cases in St. Louis County. Of course, racial disparities in juvenile justice are not new, and they are not limited to my home state. In fact, the investigation into the St. Louis County Family Court is the fourth juvenile justice operation examined by DOJ across the nation in the last 3 years. Complaints regarding two of the others in Tennessee and Texas were settled. One more in Mississippi was partly settled, but still may end in federal litigation. And on top of that, just last month, after the most recent DOJ report, the Office of State Courts Administrator, which is under the jurisdiction of the Missouri Supreme Court, released a report on their own, which found that black youths in St. Louis County were almost 4 times more likely than their white counterparts to be referred to the court. In fact, in 2013, of 70 youths referred from St. Louis County to youth services, 11 were white and 59 were black. That's 84%. The same year, 4 whites and 19 blacks were certified to stand trial as adults. So that you can fully understand just how disturbing those numbers are, according to the U.S. Census Bureau, St. Louis County is only 23% African American, so the disproportion is off the charts. I also want to briefly share with you some key findings from a national study of school suspensions published last March, which reported that black children in Missouri are more likely to be suspended from elementary school than anywhere else in the nation. So you see, that's where the madness begins. The first link in the pipeline starts with suspensions, which leads to expulsion, which leads to juvenile detention, which ends up in prison. We have to break that cycle, and as a nation, we have the capacity to do that. What we lack is the will to do it. And I will leave you with this. The words of Michael Barrett, the director of Missouri's public defender system, he said, we should be sickened by the fact that all across this country, the most vulnerable among us, poor minority children, go without the most basic protections under the Constitution. End of quote. That's what today's panel is all about. Thank you so much, and I'm looking forward to our discussion. Mr. Cravens, it's all yours.
Thank you. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen.
Good afternoon.
My name is Don Cravens, and I have the pleasure of being with you this afternoon on this wonderful, wonderful, beautiful day here in Washington, D.C., and just a wonderful first panel to start. I serve as the Executive Director of the Washington Bureau of the National Urban League as Senior Vice President of the National Urban League, and so it is an honor, Congressman, to be here today to moderate this first panel and to sit on the second panel, because I have a lot of passion on this issue as well. I want to thank the Robert F. Kennedy Foundation for helping to put this wonderful program together. I've been working with them now over the past couple of weeks to do this, and it has just been very professional and very encouraging to see the work that they do. I want to thank again our honorary co-host, the Honorable Lacy Clay. The Congressman is modest, and so I'm going to take 1 minute of personal privilege to talk to you a little bit about my friend and my mentor, and this man who is very modest. He is not the first person to be on the front line on television because it serves his political career. He's not the first person to be the loudest when tragedy struck his community because it would have served his political career. Those types of people, or leaders as they may call themselves, they think the way to lead is to lead from the front, always be the loudest, be the angriest, and though, although sometimes those characteristic traits have their place, a true leader is someone who both leads and serves. And that's what you have in William Lacy Clay Jr. He is truly a servant leader. I was talking to my assistant yesterday about the notion of a servant leader, Congressman. What makes someone different from just a leader? What makes them a servant leader? And my assistant Ebony, who was raised in the church and still attends church, she says, Donald, I have a scripture I think that describes Lacy Clay. And I want to read it for you if it's all right, Congressman. It comes from Philippians chapter 2, verses 3 through 4. And it says, do nothing from selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility count others more significant than yourselves. Let each of you look not only to his own interest, but also to the interest of others. Ladies and gentlemen, that is Congressman William Lacy Clay. He talked about some of his accomplishments, young people on the panel. Let me tell you something he did too. You remember after Ferguson, we saw the local police in that county with these big armored vehicles, right? You thought we were going to war. You had to check the news to make sure you weren't looking at Afghanistan or Iraq, but you were actually looking at America. And many of us were disturbed by those images, watching our local police in riot gear and paramilitary gear and driving tanks through the town of Ferguson. Because of Congressman Clay and his work with Congressman Cleaver, they met with Secretary Hagel, who was the Secretary of Defense at the time. And they then met with the President. And they asked the President, if we couldn't get legislation passed to stop that, could he issue an executive order to make sure that police were trained when they received that equipment? And to say some of that equipment never, ever should find its way in our local communities. And the President did issue that executive order stopping that. So Congressman, thank you for that. So our panelists, when I see these young people up here, it gives me so much hope. I want to introduce them to you today. I'm going to do the best I can to give you a little piece into who they are, but then we're going to ask questions about who they are, and they're going to get an opportunity to talk to you about what they are, who they are, where they've come from, and where they're going. The first panelist today is Ms. Jabria Handy. Jabria is a youth advocate, organizer, and spokeswoman on the issues of youth and adult court and juvenile justice reforms. She was involved in the juvenile and adult criminal courts, but is now dedicating her efforts to ensuring other youth do not have to experience the challenges of being placed in adult court and or in adult jails. She has become a leader in the juvenile justice reform movement in Baltimore and is inspiring and educating other youth to speak up for reforms. Ladies and gentlemen, Ms. Jabria Handy. Next on our panel is Ms. Quenisha Hines. Ms. Hines is a third-year law student from Newport News, Virginia. She completed her undergraduate studies at Old Dominion University and currently attends North Carolina Central University School of Law. Quenisha is an intern at the Newport News Public Defender's Office, as well as the Durham, North Carolina Legal Aid Office. Quenisha currently serves as a founding member of the Annie E. Casey Foundation Juvenile Justice Strategy Group's Youth Advisory Council, and is a governor appointee of the Virginia State Advisory Committee on Juvenile Justice. She is an experienced motivational speaker and has been personally impacted by the juvenile justice system, giving her a unique insight into the field. We welcome Ms. Quenisha Hines. Our young men on the panel today, I'm going to start with Jim St. Germain. Jim is the co-founder of Preparing Leaders of Tomorrow Incorporated, also known as PLOT, a nonprofit mentoring organization that provides mentors to justice-involved and at-risk youth. Working with young people is Jim's passion, as he has overcome many obstacles in his own life. Early in his career, Jim worked as a youth care counselor at a juvenile detention facility in New York City, where he was once a resident. Additionally, he worked as an advocate for young people living with mental disabilities at the Mental Health Association. Jim served on the Youth Advisory Council of New York State Division of Criminal Justice Services from 2008 to 2009, and is currently a member of Vera's Institute of Justice Juvenile Board. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Jim St. Germain. And last but not least, Mr. Alton Petrie. Alton is a 23-year-old native of the Jungles, a neighborhood in southern central Los Angeles. Mr. Petrie got involved in the street life and was incarcerated in two months before his high school graduation in 2009 for a robbery that he did not commit. While incarcerated, Alton solidified his passion for writing through Inside Out Writers, a nonprofit organization that conducts weekly creative writing classes within LA County juvenile jails in hopes of reducing recidivism. He also obtained his GED and his high school diploma. On his last juvenile court date, he declined a plea bargain of a year, and a strike was sent to adult court where he faced 46 years to life. 3 years later, in adult court, his case was dismissed. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Alton Petrie. As I'm reading these young people's bios, and I promise you I've shortened them down, you would swear we were talking about men and women much older. So very impressive young people. We're going to start now with a round of questions. I'm going to ask you all to answer this question, and we're going to start with you. The question is, what kind of work do you do to advocate for young people?
Hi, everyone. Thank you for having me here. I am a youth organizer in Baltimore City where I work with Just Kids campaign, and what we're trying to do is stop the automatic prosecution of youth charges of adult. So we're at the front line. We have a youth adult partnership where we, enlighten the community on what's going on. We take them to the Maryland General Assembly. We also have kids in high school statewide, and we also, get the kids that have been charged as adults to speak to the Maryland General Assembly. So we're all about changing policy as well as mentoring kids and making sure that they understand what's going on, they know their legislators and things like that.
Thank you. Q?
Hi, I spent two summers at the Public Defender's Office for a reason, because I always said that I wanted to give back to my community. And I think going back and working with the Public Defender's Office and the JDR team brings me closer to the young people, and I'm able to attend drug court programs and leadership programs so I can speak to the young people about utilizing their assets that's been given to them. I also became a part of the NEKC Foundation because we work to basically eliminate the overuse of incarceration for young people. I believe that community-based alternatives is the key, not incarceration, because they get to develop themselves.
I'm sorry, you can hear me better now? Did you hear everything I said? Okay. So I believe that incarceration is not the key. I believe if you put them back into the community where they can invest their, they can develop their skills and invest in something, so they can deter from making further mistakes. So that's a little bit of that I do with my community.
Thank you. Jim, tell us a little bit about what you do.
I work as an improvement quality specialist for the city of New York. So what I do there is that I monitor the service providers who are providing services to our young people who are currently in our juvenile justice system. In addition to that, as you know, I'm the founder of a nonprofit organization that provides mentoring college and job preparation for at-risk and formerly incarcerated young people. I'm a personal mentor to many young people myself. I go all over this country and speak on behalf of young men and women who are at risk and who are currently dealing with issues within the juvenile justice system. And I do that by using my own personal story and how I've overcame them and the services and the support that I receive, and I believe strongly would help many young people who are coming behind me.
Thank you. Alton?
Yes. Can you hear me well?
Yes.
All right, okay. So I am a member of ARC, the Anti-Recidivism Coalition. ARC, we're a unique organization because all of our members are composed of all formerly incarcerated individuals who are now pursuing productive lives in our community. ARC is twofold. The first part is to provide services and support for those coming home from incarceration. The second part is to advocate for fair and just policies in the criminal and juvenile justice system. And we've been instrumental in California at passing some bills that have given thousands of juvenile offenders second chances. And ultimately, those bills were passed because we're able to share our stories with those policymakers, basically just letting them know, like, hey, this is who I was, this is what happened, this is what I've been through, this is what helped me change, and this is what I'm doing now. And this summer, I was able to intern in D.C. with an organization called First Focus. They're a children's advocacy organization who focus on a various range of children's issues on federal policy and budget. So I was able to get my foot in on the door on a national level, you know. So I was able to advocate for the JJDPA bill. I also was able to advocate for just juvenile reform at the White House. And I'm a columnist for the JJIE, Juvenile Justice Information Exchange, where I'm just able to touch up on topics through my experience and just knowledge, and that's currently what I do right
Thank
now.
You, Alton. Congressman, I know you have to vote at some point. The Congressman will leave us at some point to go and vote. Before you leave, Congressman, I want you to hear from the young people. You've got a United States Congressman who cares about this issue seated to your left. I want you, ladies and gentlemen, to talk to him right now and tell him, and based upon your own experiences, what do you think a congressman, our federal legislature, should be doing? What could some things they could do to help? And anybody can go first.
I'll go. Congressman, thank you very much for this opportunity, and thank you for the work that you do. I know it's not easy, but it's necessary. I think one of the main things that I think Congress and folks in D.C. can really do to affect changes on a local level in our communities is really focus and trying to shift some of the resources now that we currently use on the prison system to more community-based programs. So for example, we know that young people who are giving more resources, more opportunities, are less likely to come in contact with the criminal justice system. And I think on your level, working with other officials out here in Congress, is really to try to get some of the opponents on the other side to understand that when we help young people do better, regardless of their skin tone, regardless of what area code they come from, America as a whole do better. And we'll have a better workforce, and we have better scholars, and we'll have better leaders for this country. So again, just trying to shift the focus on spending $80 billion yearly on a prison system, instead put some of that money out in the community where we help young people get the services that they need.
That's excellent.
So I'll go next.
Okay.
If this works, I don't think my mic works.
Oh, it's okay.
So basically what I strive for is definitely what Jim said, but if I had not been in this position, I wouldn't have known who Congressman Clay is or was. And I just, you know, in my community, a lot of kids that I mentor, they don't even know who their legislators are, who they can appoint to when they have a problem. So, and I know time is very precious for you guys, but just making it known, because the education is not being given to them, especially through schools or parenting, anything like that. So just making them know that you're there to help them, because a lot of us lose a lot of hope if we think that nobody is there for us.
The thing I want legislators to think of is that kids, they're still maturing. It takes time. They're transforming into adults. And I believe that's why positive youth development programs are necessary. And just like what Jim said, take all that, the resources that's put into out-of-home placements, and put them in the community. So, you know, you can, if a child knows it's surrounded by a negative environment, that's all they're going to know. Mm-hmm. But they can put their trust and their confidence in something that's in their community, and then they can have something positive to look to. So I believe that's very important when it comes to policy.
Yeah. Right. Yeah, so I'm a big believer of prevention before we are even, before we even make it to, you know, incarceration and in contact with the police, that if you invest in the kids early while they're young and still at the most vulnerable and just teachable stages in their lives, that that will reduce the need to lock them up later in life. So just the prevention right there. But like we know, you can do nothing and still get killed or go to jail. So I believe once you are incarcerated, to acknowledge that kids are kids, you know, and kids make dumb mistakes. So just the fair treatment of kids and the way they are sentenced and treated regardless of their skin color. And my mind's all over the place, but last but not least, just reentry services. A lot of people, when they are released, they go home with no friends, family, no help. And just when I was released, I was able to have help, which a lot of kids aren't able to do. So just to focus on the reintegration back into society.
Let me quickly respond, and each of you have brought up some excellent points, especially the part about how we could channel those resources, those financial resources that we spend now on incarcerating millions in this country and keeping them on paper. You know, how we could redirect those dollars into the front end. And I appreciate that, but I do believe that the message is beginning to sink in because we have such budget woes in the federal government, that now even conservatives are getting it and realize, hey, there's a savings there. I guess the key for us is to be able to capture those savings and redirect it back into our communities where it's mostly needed. Be it improving the quality of education for young people or giving them alternative ways to succeed. One issue I wanted to raise with all of you, and you can give me the feedback, is what would be helpful to young people starting in their teens on the whole issue of how we battle poverty and how we direct them into productive modes of living. What would be the most help that, say, the federal or state government could give our young people?
Well, I think, Congressman Clay, the truth is everybody in this room knows that the bottom line, right, the underlying issue that's causing most of the problems for young men and women of color is poverty, right? We know for a fact that when rich kids commit certain acts, they go to counseling, and when poor colored kids commit the same acts, they go to prison. So I think giving young people an opportunity to earn positive, to make a living in a positive way, whether it's through job training, whether it's through vocational programs, whether it's through having mentors around them and people when they look at these people, they can see themselves. Because a young person coming from such environments cannot become something that they can't see.
Right.
And many of us are not going back into these communities to reach back to them and trying to pull them out of that. So in addition to providing those resources and infrastructure for these young people to learn how to become better employers and businessmen, is that we have to go back ourselves and help and teach them and mold them and mentor them, in addition with that resources that we're talking about with job training and everything else.
Just to piggyback off of Jen, I believe education is the main thing, just because, you know, poverty is like inevitable sometimes. So, but just educating them that, hey, the system is set up against you, so you need to, you got to learn how to not put yourself in these certain situations. So, and also, like he said, you can't go somewhere that you can't see. So just investing in programs that exposes the youth to to different outlets, enabling them to step out of their comfort zones, whether it's speaking or through the mentorship. You want them to be like, hey, I don't want to do that, or like, I'm not used to that. No, you're going to do this, you know. So, and I think that was something that was beneficial for me, just having platforms, even something like this, but if not to this extent, but just to where I'm able to step out of my comfort zone and try something different.
But you're not nervous now.
Never nervous.
I think we need to stop taking the resources out of the schools, the schools in Baltimore City. A lot of the trades are being taken away. A lot of the schools are being shut down. So how can we, you know, we teach them from books that are 10, 20 years old. So those resources, those books and things like that need to be updated for them to understand, and not only just have the teachers be in the classroom, bring other people from, you know, statewide organizations and stuff like that inside the classroom so they can learn, you know, grant writing and things like that, because a lot of these kids really want to start their own business. I know I want to learn grant writing. That's one of the things I told, you know, my organization was like, okay, y'all teaching me how to be a spokesperson, but I want to learn grant writing. So, you know,
I think many would be good as computer technicians.
My nephew is 12, and he wanted to be a computer technician since the age of 10. So, and he's really striving to do that. A lot of kids, they have the hopes and dreams, they just don't have the support behind it.
And that is very, very true. The exposure piece is very critical. I know I'm a hands-on person. I have to do it enough more times. When I was had my third-year practice certificate, I had to be in that courtroom as much as possible to feel confident to do what I needed to do to be a better defense attorney. So when you have a kid who's probably not really good at school, hands-on, you know, and sometimes they don't even know how to fill out a job application. And, you know, they need that individualized attention to help you fill out a job application. What happens when you're at a point you have to answer the question, about your offenses. You don't, offenses versus convictions, it's two different things.
Sure.
I still had that problem. I was filling out my law school applications, you know, and it's like, they just need to know, you know, they need to be informed of that, of the necessary skills to maintain a life, you know, a lifestyle to get out of that poverty. So.
Thank you all for that.
Excellent. That's excellent.
Aren't they wonderful?
Yes.
Aren't they wonderful?
This next question I want to pose to Jim and Jabria. Tell us a little bit about how you interpret the social movements, the uprisings in your cities, and how they've impacted the issues on which you work. We'll start with you, Jim.
The uprising, and I think the outcry that you're seeing now in almost every corner of America, it's not new. It's something that has been going on for a very long time. You know, young people, particularly young people of color, have been marginalized and have been pushed to the limit. And now with the access of social media and people having camera phones and things all around them, we're able to speak about these issues much more, on a much larger scale and much freely. But these issues aren't new, they're not isolated. And as the congressman talked about earlier, this starts from the school to prison pipeline. And I give you an example. I have a son that's 2 years old, and my son is my world. He means everything to me. And I recently just learned that in America, a black child in pre-K, right? Pre-K, we're talking about 2-3 years old, is 5 times more likely to get suspended than a white child in pre-K. Like, can you imagine what a 2 and 3 year old can possibly do in pre-K to be suspended and expelled from school? It happens all the time. So I think those issues that you're seeing now has been brewing over time. And I think we're getting to a point where we're fed up, right? So we're speaking up, we're speaking out, and I think we're trying to mobilize and make changes in any way possible, right? If we can't expect certain policymakers to go ahead and make these changes for us, we're gonna have to go ourselves and push them as much as we can. So, you know, all of that, the issues that you're seeing, as I said earlier, they're not isolated. They're all connected, and they all feed into each other. And the bottom line is poverty, inequality. It's a system that do not treat you fairly. Literally, I know that if I get pulled over or if I get arrested, I'm not going to get the same treatment as perhaps my friend Adam, who's sitting there. And to me, that's troublesome. So, you know, I think that's what I contribute to.
Jabir, tell us about Baltimore.
Well, I really don't speak much on the Freddie Gray incident. And I think it's because in Baltimore, we have very diverse organizing skills. And you have some people that allow their organizing to be more so an outrage versus educating themselves on how to do better. And so I think that they're trying to better themselves and moving forward with, you know, the how they take on the events that's going on and not more so like vandalizing the city. That ordeal during that time was very, very, very hard for me. I'm a very soft person when it comes to my city. I don't like people talking about it. But I can't really speak much on it because I don't involve myself with that incident because the people that are at the forefront, we kind of have some, you know,
disagreement
as far as how they do certain things. So I, you know, I wish the best for the family and how, you know, how things go, but I can't really speak much on it.
Okay.
This next question is for Q. Q, what are the benefits of community-based interventions and diversion programs over incarceration?
Well, I don't think people really think about how a criminal record can affect people's lives. I mean, you have to explain that when you apply for jobs. You have to explain that when you apply for school. And it's like, why not divert them to a community-based alternative that focuses on positive youth development so they can invest in something that they really care about, and it will deter them from messing up the opportunities that was afforded to them. So I believe if they are given the opportunity to positively develop versus sitting in a confined space, I mean, how can you weigh the two, you know? And it's like, diversion can be at all stages of the juvenile justice system, you know? And I believe Jim spoke about how, or what Alton spoke about how preventative programs, you know, invest in that early so we can divert them from even getting to that point where they're entering into the juvenile justice system. So I believe, like I said earlier, I always say this on my council and they laugh at me because they know what I'm about to say. And it's like, I believe positive youth development is just the key. Young people are still growing, they're still maturing, and they have so much room to grow. And they have so much room to think about the stuff that they do before they do it, once they're given an opportunity to invest in something that they really care about.
Great. Alton, you write for the Juvenile Justice Information Exchange. What role do media outlets like that play in the reform movement, and how do we ensure that more youth voices are present in them?
Yes, that media outlet is huge because, you know, as the world knows, the media is what drives the opinion of the public, you know. So as far as JJIE, it's a very beneficial platform because I'm in a unique position to share my story as opposed to the other writers who are, they're not black, most of them aren't black, they are professionals in their setting and in their field, and I'm a youth who's, you know, striving, aspiring to be in their positions, but I'm given a unique position because I'm able to speak on my personal experiences, how I've been affected, what works and what doesn't work. And it's been served well because I'm able to get my voice out. Not necessarily people who know who I am, but I'm more interested in people hearing what I have to say than who I am, you know, because at the end of the day, the inspiration is in hopes of, it's in hopes of inspiring, you know, the youth to see like, oh, hey, he's from the streets. Now he's at Morehouse. Now he's doing big things, you know. Or those policymakers to say, hey, you know, he's the real expert here, you know. He has some knowledge. So those type of platforms are crucial. And I think more youth needs to get involved. And writing is a skill. It's a talent. I worked hard at it, so it didn't just come easy. But that's where that education comes in early on, you know, so the youth are inspired to, hey, I want to write, you know.
Before we get to some questions from the audience, I've been wanting to ask this question because this is where you get to be creative. If you were a foundation and you had money to invest and to create a program in your area, what would that program look like? We're going to start with you, Q.
Well, I would kind of be stealing the program that I already like so much in my community. I will put more money in that program. It's okay. Called the STEP program, and it's probably similar to a lot of other programs with different names, but it's a 10-week program that allows young people to come to a place, it's a safe haven, where they have different levels of mentorship, where they help you fill out a GED application, a college application, a job application, and they also partner with different agencies and employers where these young people can go and seek employment, criminal record or not. They allow the young people to go and practice what they want to do and do it in real life terms. And, you know, and they're working 8-hour shifts, so they're busy all during the day, and then they're making money. So they're making legal money, so and it's like, what's better than that? Do I really want to go to jail doing something illegal, or do I want to go to work making legal money? So I would invest in that.
Well, let me first say that personally, I do not believe that any young person is inherently bad. I think each and every one of us sitting in this room, whether you had a beautiful background, you had both parents at home, you had a great education. If you didn't have those resources and that path that was created and passed down to you, you know, you would struggle also. So I think it's important for us to look at young people and realize that if we just give them an alternative, if we give them something else to do, I promise you most of them will actually choose to do right. So for me, my initiative would be a combination between mentoring and job employment. So I would pay young people with a professional for about 32 weeks. That person would be their mentor, and they would learn from that person as much as they can. And at the end of that 32 week, that young person will end up getting a job at different organizations or different corporations around whichever state or city they're from. So you know, you're getting two for one. You're not just helping them with employment opportunities, but you're also pairing them with a mentor that would teach them some of the necessary skills that they need to survive and maneuver in society, and also to stay out of trouble. Yeah.
Jabria, what would you do?
This is my plan, and it's gonna come soon. Y'all gonna see it because I'm really working on it. It's a reentry program, a reentry housing program. For both juveniles that's coming out of the criminal justice system as well as juveniles coming out of the juvenile system. And what we see so often is that juveniles coming out of the criminal justice system are just, to in instances, criminals. They don't get help. They don't get, you know, GED training or anything like that. You have some programs that might give it to them, but a lot of these, if they weren't introduced to them, they wouldn't be allowed to do it. And so my program accepts all kids from all systems, and we're basically going to have a housing situation where as though you can stay there for a long-term basis, and you receive different trainings based on the connections that I have with you guys.
Alton? Yes, so I would create a program that's similar to like Inside Out Writers and ARC. You know, it would be a program for all youth, whether if they've been incarcerated or not, record or no record, it doesn't matter. And we would focus on writing, but with the twist, music is, like, kids love music, you know, so I would use, like, hip-hop. Maybe we analyze some lyrics, some of the good ones, some of the bad ones, you know, to just get their brains, you know, just running, get to thinking about what's going on, because I believe that rappers are really, like, the true leaders. If they just speak a positive message, they have the biggest impact, I believe, more than anyone, at least for our youth today. But I would focus on that, but also, it would be extended. We would focus on, you know, the history of African Americans. We would have vocational trainings, you know, what to do if you need a job interview. Like, I volunteer at a juvenile justice center in Atlanta, And I be talking to the kids, 14, 15, 16, a lot of them don't even know, like, what's the process to get a job. And so just to explain them that, just the simple things, you know, like, hey, your appearance, how you gonna get a job, you sagging, you know, you haven't even combed your hair. Mm-hmm. Just simple things like that, and just provide, like, speaking engagements, field trips, just to have that fun. And also, I would use everything they have learned for us to go out to the state capitol in D.C. and just advocate for just youth in general.
Jim, I want to ask you, since your time in the system and working with the system in your state, is it getting better or worse? And then I want you to tell me a little bit about the young men and women who are in it now. Mm-hmm. What do they think about it?
I would say that it's getting better. I remember approximately 6 years ago, New York State, my state, we were sued by the federal government. I think General Eric Holder, your pal. who's also from Queens, New York, he sued New York State because of the way we were treating our young people who are in the juvenile justice system. New York State was really hands-on when it comes to how we dealt with young people who are in the juvenile justice system. I remember we had two instances upstate New York where two young people were killed while being restrained. Mm-hmm. So the federal government wrote to us and said, hey, you guys have two options. Either you're going to clean this up or we're going to take it over. And of course, because everything is driven by money, New York State said, I don't want you to take over our juvenile justice system because it's bringing a lot of money into the state. So we'll find a way to fix it. So one of the things we did, which I worked on with the former mayor, Bloomberg, and Governor Cuomo, was to initiate this program called Close to Home. So basically, a kid from New York City, from the five boroughs, when they get arrested, which 90% of the kids who get arrested in New York are from New York City, the five boroughs, they would have to go to upstate New York to these facilities that are 10 hours away from their house to do their time. And the problem we had was the parents couldn't really travel all the way up there to visit these young people. So basically, we isolated these young people, and we placed them in facilities where people who were working with them did not look nothing like them. So they couldn't relate to the workers. Parents couldn't come visit them. They were really miserable. So what we did is that we brought them back home. So right now in New York State, most of the young people who are getting arrested, they're going to group home-like settings in their own neighborhood in their areas where their families can just travel 10, 15 minutes away to come visit them. That's one of the things we worked on, and I think it's really helping how young people are seeing the system right now. Again, they're closer to their family, they're closer to their neighborhood, their parents can come and check on them. We can take them to different outings around the city and show them that there is more outside of the neighborhood than what they're accustomed to. But on the back end, New York and North Carolina are the only two states in this nation that still try juveniles from the age of 16 to 18 mm-hmm. as adults. Which is horrible. Just imagine a 16, a 17-year-old being charged as an adult for petty crimes. So we had a young man, I don't know if you guys heard of him, his name was Khalif Browder. Yeah. A young man who was allegedly arrested for stealing a backpack. Then he was placed on Rikers Island because we have a broken system. And while he was on Rikers Island, this young man was abused, physically abused by the staff. He was raped. He was beaten almost all day long. And he was in a solitary confinement for 23 hours a day. Eventually, Khalif stayed there for 3 years, came home. His mental health deteriorated, and he ended up killing himself. And here I am, who had a felony charge when I was 15. But because I was 15, I was under 16. I was given a chance to go into a juvenile justice facility, more like a group home setting where I got help. And look where I am today, where this young man committed a crime that was 10 times, you know, less than the crime I committed, and he ended up dying in the system because we didn't provide the right services to them. So another thing we're working on right now in New York and North Carolina is to try to raise the age to get the legislature to charge 16 and 17-year-olds as kids that they are, because we know that their brains are not fully matured until they're about 25 years old. Right. So we tell them they can't buy certain things, they can't have a credit card, they can't buy liquor, but yet, if they commit a crime, they can be charged as an adult, which makes no sense. So these are some other things we're working on. We're making progress, and I think the kids can see it, but we still have a long way to go.
Well, look, I'm glad you brought up the Browder issue because I know Representative Sheila Jackson Lee has some legislation that's going to be called the Browder Bill, where she's going to want to authorize some of the block grant money, the Juvenile Accountability Block Grant Program, to make sure that that doesn't happen again. And so all of you out there, we need to support the Congresswoman in her efforts. Jabria, better or worse, and what do young people today think of the juvenile justice system where you live?
I think it's better. We issued a bill and came to a consensus with the Department of Juvenile Services in my state, where we have 33 automatically charged offenses in Maryland. And so some of those offenses where a kid is charged for the first time will be held in juvenile detention centers and given judge discretion. And when the judge finds that that person is at harm to himself or herself or the society, then they may be waived up. We're still working on the automatic prosecution of youth charged as adults, so we're trying to stop that altogether. But I think we're making progress because I've been working on this campaign for 5 years, and we first started out with the $104 million jail that the governor was trying to build. And, you know, we rallied around that issue. And so, you know, bill by bill, every year we're in the Maryland General Assembly. Youth first, we're at the front. And we're doing it, and I see that more youth are coming forward and speaking. This is actually my first time being on a panel with another young woman, so I'm excited today. Because I know I'm always with you.
Guns fall.
Thank you, Jabria. Alton, what about you, better or worse? And what are young people saying that are in the system now?
That are in the system?
Currently in the system. I know you meet with young people now. What are their views?
Honestly, I believe their views, they don't believe in the system. Just totally, they don't believe in it. I have a friend who was received 80 years to life for, at the age of 17, you know.
80?
Yes, 80 years to life. I was even incarcerated. There was this dude, they gave him 300 years in 11 months or something like that. Like, 11 months? Like... Yeah, so they're basically, and those sentences were to be served, consecutively?
Yes.
Not concurrently consecutively. So basically they're saying like, hey, we want you to die.
Three times in prison.
You know, reincarnate yourself, go back to jail. So I believe that the youth, they don't believe in the system whatsoever. However, California, we have been coming along. Just this year alone, we passed several bills that has been very beneficial to the youth. One that I haven't been there lately, but one that I did help advocate for was a bill called SB 260. 260 was introduced by Senator Hancock, and it provides, it guarantees parole eligibility for youth who committed a crime under the age of 18. So it's not a get out of jail free card, but it's just an incentive and hope saying that, hey, if you do what you need to do after 15 to 25 years, depending on the type of your crime, you are eligible for parole. And just recently, an extension of that was SB 261, which extends that to the age of under 23, which acknowledges the brain science of the youth. And It's just an extension of from age 18 to age 23, and right now is waiting for Governor Brown to sign it. So that's how we're coming up. Yeah.
The young people that I interact with in the system, they describe the system as very punitive. They feel like the system highlights their flaws rather than praise their strengths. So they feel like the system is waiting for them to mess up so they can just punish them very severely. And they think the system is racist. And they think...
They're right.
Tell them. And they anticipate getting treated negatively. Mm. So that's the kind of feedback that I get back from the kids in the system now.
Okay, I'm going to ask you guys one more question, and then we're going to open it up to the audience. And this one talks about education, and I think maybe Jim, you talked about education. It's held out as the great equalizer, right? Everybody's grandmother, great-grandmother has always said, baby, get your education, right? Has it been easy for you to get access to education? And if not, what barriers to education have you or other young people impacted by the justice system experienced? And I'm going to start with you, Jabria.
I would say, me personally, no, it hasn't no, it has been easy for me to get, it's kind of like I could have got education, but I couldn't have at the same time because coming home, I came home on a juvenile probation period where I was still, I had took a plea bargain, I was still tried as an adult, and I still had the adult conviction, but I still came home on juvenile probation. And so during that time, it was a lot of things hindering me. Within juvenile services, they give you, you know, vouchers for clothing, housing, and things like that. But if you're convicted as a felon, they say, no, you can't have it, even though you're on juvenile probation. So during that time, education was the farthest from my mind because I was trying to find a place to leave my head. I do have, we had a person that used to be in our campaign where I was just telling my colleagues that he was in school for about 2 weeks and actually sitting sitting at a desk where they came in and told him that he had to leave the campus. And why? Because he had a felony on his record. He was like, I'm doing good and my attendance is great, you know, I greet everybody with respect, and that was such a long time ago, but they didn't care. So, you know, sometimes like the collateral consequences are almost deadly to a person's, you know, access to success.
Q?
I was actually really fortunate to have access to education because I had a mentor to show me how to fill out a college application, how to fill out financial aid applications, and how to fill out my law school application. However, that was my situation. I mean, had I not been outgoing, I'm an outgoing person, not everybody's like me. I reached out and I said, hey, can you help me? Not a lot of people will do that, especially if you have a mother with an 8th grade education, a father with a 10th grade education. Who else am I going to ask besides my parents? They don't know how to fill out these documents. And so I think, although I was fortunate and I was blessed to get the access to education, a lot of people are in my predicament with parents with without the experience of higher education, and they don't have the access or the help to go through the process.
Brother Jim?
I've had a very unique situation. I was born in Haiti. I moved to Brooklyn, New York when I was 10 years old. So from birth to about 10, I never attended school because my parents couldn't afford it back home. And then when I got here, I fell right into the streets, and I was in the streets hustling. So I missed a lot of schooling. Finally, at the age of 16, 17, I picked up my first book and started to read. And it was the first book was Dreams from My Father, which I'm reading again for the second time. And, you know, I did realize that education allows me to move forward and do a lot better in life, despite all of the shortcomings, despite all of the inequalities and inequities which we know about. We do know that a white person with a high school diploma is 5 times more likely to get a job than a black person with a college degree. We understand that. There is no doubt about that. But at the same time, I do believe that education is the greatest equalizer. And if I wasn't able to make it through college, and I'm currently at NYU now getting my master's, but one of the things that I encountered when I got to NYU that really frustrates me was the fact that I was in class with students from China, Africa, all over the world who had a full ride scholarship. And here I am, a young man who's been in this country almost all his life, who beat the odds like you can't imagine, and NYU decided not to give me a dime to go to school. So that was harsh to me. That was pretty painful. So I think we need to start looking at young people who've been through struggles and obstacles, young people who've been through the juvenile justice system, through the same lens that we look at every other young person. Maybe they got caught up and they made a mistake, they got arrested, but we're no different than any other person you see walking down the streets. No one sitting in this room, or for that matter, all over the world, I view them as better than I am. So I think the educational system needs to treat young people the same way and give them opportunities regardless of their background.
Right, thank you. Alton?
Yeah, so I always just thank God and my grandmother for just instilling in me the faith to overcome at a young age. So that's why when I was incarcerated, like, I was incarcerated 2 months before my high school graduation, like, and I had an alibi. I was going to night school because I had failed some classes. I didn't want to be the one who, like, went to school my whole life and didn't graduate. I might as well have dropped out like my homies, you know? But so when I was incarcerated, I did get my GED high school diploma, but I can honestly say that was just off personal strength and just from the Lord. It just, I had to work twice as hard to combat my negative circumstance. But it was easy when I was released, because inside our riders, they helped me one-on-one with the process of how to apply for a school application and everything. So once they showed me, I just took it around with it on my own. But one thing that has been hindering me, I can't say not totally, because God always helped me find a way, but just like tuition is $47,000. So it's like, and if anyone who qualifies for financial aid, it's me. Like, like if anybody qualifies, like, I've been awarded the court and fostered, like all of that, you know. And when I was in junior college, I actually had to kind of like work the system. They were trying to say, oh, I wasn't technically in foster care and this or that. So it was a lot of obstacles I had to go through, but you know, I got it done. So it was easy getting into it, but the hard part is staying in it.
Very good. All right, so at this point, we're gonna open up for questions, but I have to give a rule here. I was on a panel yesterday, and when we opened it up for panel, people then thought they could come and be part of the panel and testify. This is not time for you to come testify, even though I know you feel the passion of these young people. This is a time that if you have a question that I've not asked, or that you want to ask one of these young people for an answer, because you need an answer, this is an educational, please at this time, come to the mic and ask your question.
Can I say something before you
Sure, absolutely, Jabria.
So for all our juvenile justice advocates in here, if you represent juvenile justice, next month is YJAM month, Youth Justice Awareness Month. So get with your states and just figure out what fundraising opportunities you guys can donate to, because, you know, these organizations, we're very hard trying. So just make sure that you look up YJAM, the hashtag, and look in your state and see what's going on in your state.
Very good. All right, question. Sir, please use the mic.
I think the lady behind you was first.
Okay. All right, I'm sorry.
Ladies first.
I have eyes in the back of my head.
That's why I'm here to help you.
Thank you, I appreciate that. My name is Mary. I'm a lifelong educator from toddlers all the way up to university students. And I've transitioned into working directly in policy on a program that tries to identify and support students who are in 6th to 8th grades who are struggling, who look like they're on the verge of dropping out of school, to keep them on track. So my question for each one of you is, think about yourselves now, but also your 6th grade, your 7th grade, your 8th grade, your 9th grade selves. What are some ways of reaching out? What are the questions to ask? And especially because I'm going to be working directly with the teachers in those schools who often look very completely different and come from very different backgrounds from the students.
Right.
How can I support those teachers in truly helping those students early on, before we lose them?
Great question. Jim, you want
to? Yeah, there was this quote, can't remember if it's from Marcus Garvey or Frederick Douglass, but it states that children and kids do not care how much you know until they know how much you care. And I think as a teacher, working with young people, particularly those who are at risk coming from our environment, we have to sort of like break down the barriers, regardless of where those teachers are coming from. If they can find the compassion and the caring hearts to look at these children as children that they are, and I think that will open up a lot of doors and allowing the young people to let whoever it is to come help them. Because young people, when they need help, they really do not care who's providing the help, as long as they know that the help is coming from a genuine source. So I think that would be my answer to your comment. I hope that's helpful. It's to help those teachers view these young people as the young people that they are.
Very good.
Yeah.
Did anyone want to answer the questions? You want to go?
I'll chime in just real quick. So when I was on the inside, and one of the teachers, one of my writing teachers from Inside Our Writers, one thing he always told us was that, you know, although I'm the teacher, you know, you're teachers as well. I can learn from you as much as you can learn from me. So just to recognize that it works both ways, you know.
Exactly right.
Very good.
I'm sorry, bro. I wasn't picking on you, by the way.
No, it's totally okay. Yeah. I got it.
Gotcha.
I got to learn to, you know, roll my head, my eyes back so I can see. So I am an educator. I've been an educator for 20 years. I teach eighth grade. But I also work with the Chicago Teachers Union as a professional development facilitator. Mm-hmm. So I've been working with young people on restorative practices. Mm-hmm. But Jim?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, so since you picked on me, but I'm going to yellow that.
You got thick skin.
No. I know. So I heard you say in your comments earlier that it's about the money, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so part of the problem is that the penal system and the juvenile justice system,
right.
I put the justice out of there if you ask
right.
me,
right.
There's no justice there. But anyhow, you said the money is so entrenched,
mm-hmm.
right? The system is so deeply rooted. This is, Michelle Alexander talks about this in her book, right? So my question to you is, seeing that that is the case, that it is, it's a system.
It's a
complex. It's a business.
Yeah.
What can be done about that? Because in my opinion, if you've read the book by Neil Bernstein, she has this book called Burning Down the House.
Right.
The juvenile justice system should be burned down.
Right.
It shouldn't even exist.
Right.
Young people have no place in it. So anyway, what do we do when we know the money is so deeply rooted in this?
He got your back, didn't he?
He got me. You got me because, you know, we live in a capitalist society and money drives everything. That's including the educational system and the juvenile justice system, as you said. I think really is to go back to us as a society, as a people, right, as a community. I think we can't expect a system that was created to suppress us to all of a sudden change and help us, right? We can try to work within the system to change it. There's no doubt about that. I know some great people like my mentor, Liston B, who's doing a lot of great work with OJJDP and the Justice Department to trying to change the system. But I think it also goes back to us as a community, the teachers, pastors, all of us who are in the community to help these young people understand that the system is making a profit off of them. And a part of stopping that problem is for them to understand it and not buy too much into it and get involved in it. Because the machine is very powerful and it's well oiled. And I think if we focus too much on trying to dismantle it alone, we're gonna have a really hard time. So I think those young people who are viewed as commodity within the system, we need to help them to understand how the system view them. And then in turn, I think they'll start externalize and internalize certain behaviors that would help to slow the machine down a little bit.
Very good.
I hope that's helpful.
We've got time for one more question.
Gosh, that's big. Make it a good one. I just want to commend all you guys so much. I'm sitting here in tears almost. You know, I'm an emancipated former foster youth myself. I'm an ex-felon myself. I went through clean slate program, you know, expungement, blah, blah, right? Here I am, 33 years old. I'm back in community college, and I'm graduating this May, double major. Thank you. And I'm transferring over to, well, I'm presumptuously speaking, Cal Berkeley, rhetoric, okay, a department at Cal Berkeley. But my question is, And I know, and I went through the legal system in my 20s, young adult. Here I am, 33. It took, I want to say, about a decade for me to restore faith in myself, to even have that faith to go back to school, to even think I could do anything with myself, you know? I want to know for you guys, it seems like it happened early on. You guys all seem pretty youthful. And what programs did you receive? What programs would you have wanted to receive, even in the group home? You know, I didn't know college was free. That information wasn't really accessible to me. I didn't know a lot. So, what programs? And I know the answer to this, but you said to make it in the form of a question. What programs would you guys recommend? What did you need? You know, even if it was a minute service or somebody thinks that, well, you know, really? That's like holding your hand. That's damn near what we need, you know? But what programs did you receive to help you get it pretty quickly? You know, you're at Morehouse. How old are you? Sorry, I'm sorry.
24.
You're 24 years old. You know, I'm 34 years old. So what, I want to know what services you got, and what didn't you get
to where it could kind of catch, you know? And somebody mentioned preschool. What could somebody do in preschool to possibly get kicked out of school or something like that? Of course, these are learned behaviors, but from the parents too. So we're talking about educating the parents in the home, you know, from when their kids are young as well. But that's another question. But what programs and services did you receive and would you need or would you even recommend to have the youth get it early on, so you're not like me at 34 trying to make it happen?
Gotcha.
Got it.
So good. What
question.
Programs you use or do you need? That's the question.
Yeah. Just a touch up on the, I am 24, but like I said, I'm probably older than most seniors at my college, so I kind of feel you. But
kind of feel her.
But like you said, like, hold your hand and walk with you. Like, that's when I was released, I literally, like, the first month, my mentor took me to, I believe it was El Camino College, and took me to the computer right there with me and just showed me everything. And like I said, I took it and ran with it. So some kids do need you to walk with them through the whole step, but a lot of them, if you just take them to the door, they'll get in the building themselves, you know? So just, I would say that's the first part, like a program that focuses on just the education part. Hey, we're going to get a van. We're going to take everybody. We're going to go to the college. We're not going to just sit in the computer lab and go. We're going to go to the actual college. But both works, whether we sit in the classroom, in the computer lab, but I would rather, you know, in person, one-on-one, so they can interact with the students and the faculty and staff.
You?
It does take time. It takes time to establish that confidence in you. And I mean, I just had a little attitude when I was, you know, a teenager, and that was my biggest problem. I was in the system from 12 to 16, and I was locked up for not making my bed. You know what I mean? Violation of probation. Wow. And it's like, you gonna treat me like a criminal, I'm gonna act like a criminal. You know, right. And it's like, okay, I'm make a criminal. I didn't make my bed. What can I do next? Right. So it's like, it didn't take me until drug court. I had a really bad alcohol problem, and it was the support system. I had a case manager who showed me individual attention. I mean, the attention that I needed, that I specifically needed, you know, to stay on the right path. And then a therapist who is still my mentor to this day. I called her yesterday so she could tell me I'm going to do a good job here, you know. And the same mentor who I called after I graduated drug court to say, hey, I don't even have an email account. Can you help me? I sure will. Mm. I don't have to. You know, you graduated a year ago, but I'll help you. Hey, can you help me fill out this law school application? I sure will. I don't have to. You graduated 4 years ago. So, I mean, it was the support system, and a really good friend of mine made me realize that why did I need drug court to have that support system? You know, why did I need drug court to get me on that path? And another thing I realized was that, you know, by the age of 16, I was maturing, you know? So of course I'm gonna get out of those bad habits, and of course I'm gonna think about what I do, you know, before I do it, because I got a good job now. You know, I wanna be a lawyer, so I have to get into school now, you know? And so the programs that I recommend is, I mean, it's hands-on. It is hands-on. I mean, my hand still gets held to this day. And I mean, that's what you need. You just need a consistent support in any shape or form.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, I think you will join me in agreeing that this is one of the best panels I've ever witnessed in my entire life. Excellent, excellent, excellent. We actually have another panel, and I will tell you, it will be hard to follow this act, but I want to thank you all, ladies and gentlemen, on the panel for being here. And again, I want to thank the Robert F. Kennedy Foundation for putting this wonderful event on. And at this point, we will ask our second round of panelists to please come up. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks for having us.